I'll never forget Jimmy Greaves. Yeah. He said, at this rate, he said, you'll break my record. And I just laughed at him. There's this little bloke, Maradona, right? And then he says, has anyone got any boots? I said, Diego, please be my guest. And afterwards, he signed the boots, and I've still got them today. Adel Taarabt came in. He knocked on my door 3 days in. You must build the team around me. He said, I am Zinedine Zidane.
So, here we are. Yes, me, Michael Dawson, for another episode of Off The Shelf with my co-host, Paul Miles. How are you, mate?
I'm great, Dawes. It's great to be back. It feels like we've never been away.
We've had a little time off. I've had a holiday.
I've been on tour with Spurs, so that was great for a couple of weeks. Perth, Singapore, Bangkok.
Was there no sun?
A little bit of sun.
There was plenty of rain, though, as well, wasn't there?
A lot of rain.
A lot of rain, too much. Well, I haven't had no rain. And our next guest, he needs no introduction. The one and only goal-scoring machine, Clive Allen. Welcome, Clive.
Thank you, Michael. Good to be here. Good to see you, Milesy.
Good to see you, Clive. Good to see you, Clive. Let's introduce Clive, shall we? 84 goals in 135 appearances over 4 years, 84 to 88. And what is less known, Michael, is he actually did a 9-year stint in the coaching team as well, during which time he would have coached you. So that's worth telling people to start with. Clive's a long affiliation with the club. Born in May 1961, which I don't need to tell fans how important that date is. And he was there when we won the double at Wembley, even though he wasn't born. He will tell us that story.
He will. So, Clive, growing up in Stepney in the 60s, how was it?
It was great fun, Michael. Obviously, I was born into a footballing family, as Milesy said. Born 3 o'clock on a Saturday afternoon. That's when football was always played and kicked off. So whether that was an omen as to what was going to be for the rest of my life, but football's been a way of life. I was at Wembley, where my dad, playing in the double side, won the double. I was in mum's tum and popped out 2 weeks later. So I always say it's in my blood. And obviously I grew up with my father telling me that he played for the greatest Tottenham team ever. And he's played for the greatest Tottenham team ever in terms of what they achieved, a magnificent team. And I was very fortunate that, you know, I had an upbringing with a father who was tough in respect of what he demanded of me. But it was a great education, certainly in football. Football, as I say, was a way of life.
A lot of people, Clive, say they grew up in a footballing family. But let's just break this down. You grew up in a footballing family where your father has just spearheaded what many people at the time, well, they called him the team of the century. They've just achieved something that people didn't think was possible back then. Won the double, and you're growing up in this household. How was it?
It was amazing. Obviously, I think I always said I had such an insight into the way the game was played, what was needed to play the game from an early age. I started playing at 6 years of age. I kicked a ball from the day I walked, and obviously the help, the guidance that my father gave me was just massive in terms of how I developed from a... I always said I was a professional from 6 years of age as far as football was concerned.
Is that something that you always dreamed of doing? I mean, we'll go back to your school days, talk about your academic achievements and things like that, but was football just the drive that was the only thing that drove you?
It was all I was ever going to do, Michael. That's all I ever had in my mind. There were stages in my life at school, teachers who wanted me to continue my education, go to university, things like that. But no, there was only one thing I was going to do.
Were you good at school, though?
I was okay. Yeah, I was all right. My maths teacher thought I should go to university at 16 when I left school and said to my parents, he really should go to university. He's good enough at 16. He'll be good enough at 18 or 20 when he leaves university. I left at 16 and made my debut at 17 for Queen's Park Rangers. So that was all I wanted to do.
Yeah. Always numbers. Those numbers have followed you around your career. Clive literally knows every goal we ever scored. Honestly, we'll get into that. Look, obviously, look. So you got your dad as a, you know, incredible role model. But when did you know yourself, Clive? When did you think, I'll tell you what, I can do this?
I think my earliest experience of actually going to a professional club, I went to Ipswich, who was a big club at the time, and Bobby Robson was manager there as a schoolboy. I'd played at White Hart Lane on the Monday night for London schools against Bristol schools. And there was two young players in the Bristol team called Mabbott, Gary and his brother Kevin. We beat Bristol schools 5-1, I think it was. And I scored a hat-trick that night playing in the Spurs youth team kit. So I think that was when I had that. I had the cockerel on my chest for the very first time. We played and we won and I scored a hat trick. And obviously it was quite big news. London Evening Standard the following night wrote an article saying, you know, player for the future. I was 14 years of age. Didn't sign for Ipswich, went to Man City. Came here to Spurs as well as a schoolboy before I went to Queen's Park Rangers, which was, I would always say it was the club I grew up at because my grandfather took me there as a six-year-old, watched my father play, was player manager there. And the opportunity to go to Queen's Park Rangers, I think, because I always called it my second home because that's where I grew up. I kicked around on the pitch with the players when I was very young. I knew everybody there when I left school at 16 and went on the staff at Queen's Park Rangers.
Just before we go into that, Clive, there's one thing, and you've told me about this before, but there's one thing that's fascinating. You used to go to White Hart Lane with your dad for the games, and he used to take you into the change room with this double team, all these incredible players. I mean, 6, 7, 8 year old, what was that like?
Well, it was always amazing. The thing I remember vividly was going to games later on when I was a little bit older, 7, 8, 9, when dad used to take me and walking down the high road. And people stopping him, obviously recognising him. And always some people turning and saying, oh, is this your son? Yeah. Well, I tell you what, if you're half the player your dad was, you'll be a player. And that always sticks in my mind. And that was Spurs supporters way back in the late 60s.
Clive, we know you've scored goals, or you scored goals all your career, many of them. Were you always a striker?
I started as a left winger, Michael, when I was very young, I think purely because of size. So when I started at 6, I was playing under-10s football. I was pretty obviously small and a lot younger than the other players. So I started as a wide player on the left, but really playing in the middle and obviously wanting to score goals, was the place to be. So I would have said probably from about a 9-year-old, I was in my age group, and that was when I really sort of focused and harnessed everything to the goal scoring.
Working hard, getting that mental side of your scoring goals.
Absolutely, yeah. I had hundreds of terrible games, Michael, but I scored 2 or 3 goals in those games. Yeah. It wasn't so bad then. Yeah.
Is it something that came naturally to you, scoring goals? We've spoken often about this, Clive, when we've watched strikers, when you've been a pundit, and we often talk about it's just you can't teach that. It's just a natural thing. Did you have that from an early age?
I think so, yeah. I think, obviously, I always felt I was born with a talent. Obviously, you know, I worked hard at all aspects of the game. Dad emphasised that, you know, you have to be able to kick it with both feet. You have to be able to head it. You have to get in the right place at the right time. It was all those things that I think were ingrained in me from a very early age that just stood me in good stead. As I grew, as I played, you can sense situations, you can understand what's going on in the game. So I was very fortunate to have that sort of upbringing and education.
Clive, QPR was your first pro club. How did you get your foot in the door? How did that come about?
Well, it was the great Jim Gregory, who was chairman at the time. Obviously, he was chairman when my father played and when he was manager there. And I met him many times as a youngster. And I'll never forget the one time I was kicking around on Loftus Road after the team had played, and he came to the edge of the director's box high up in the stand, and he ushered me up, he waved me up. He took me into his office and he said, I want you to sign this little bit of paper. So I was a kid, I didn't know what was happening. I signed the paper, and on the day I signed my first pro contract, I was in the same office. He took the piece of paper out of the top drawer of his desk and he put it on and he said, I told you you'd sign for us one day.
How many years before was that?
So that was, I was 6 and I was 17, so 11 years before.
Wow, what a story that is.
So I always have a love for the club, and obviously Mr. Gregory was a great man who really built QPR from a third division club all the way up to the Premier League before he sold the football club. But no, that was a great memory and I couldn't quite believe it. There I was. I was shaking, signing my first professional contract at 17, and he just turned to me and he went, I told you you'd sign for us one day.
Brilliant. Now, after QPR, Clive, it's obviously still very early in your career, you had one of the strangest, and I remember this as a kid, one of the strangest sort of transfer situations. Now, knowing now in hindsight how long you actually spent at that club down the road, it's almost as if that blue and white blood that's going through your veins was telling you something. Tell us what happened.
Well, I was at Queen's Park Rangers. I'll never forget it. On a Tuesday afternoon, having finished training, and I went into Alan Mullery's office. Alan Mullery, obviously, you know, a legend of Spurs, but was manager of QPR at the time. And it was the first time I've ever asked for a transfer. Obviously, it was my second spell at Queen's Park Rangers. Went into his office just before the season was about to start. And I said, I really think I need to move on. Well, you're not going anywhere. We haven't signed. We need to sign another forward. We just signed Gary Bannister from Coventry. So I said, but Gary Bannister's just arrived. You have a replacement. And it was just bizarre. It really was bizarre that I got home and I got a phone call from Terry Neal. And there I was on my way to Arsenal. I hadn't been told by the club that I was going. I arrived at Highbury, spoke to Terry Neal, signed a 3-year contract. But the most crazy thing of all, which again is vivid in my mind, was it was the first £1 million transfer for a teenager in world football. It never happened before. And it made the front page of the Sun newspaper, the front page. The game's gone mad. How can anybody be worth 18? I was just turned 18. How can anybody be, you know, transferred for that amount of money at that age? So, but I think like you, Michael, all I wanted to do, the transfer was going on around me and the sums of money and everything. All I wanted to do was play. I was 18. I'd only had 2 seasons at QPR. I just wanted to play football. And Arsenal had just lost the FA Cup final to West Ham. Paul played for West Ham in that FA Cup final. And Arsenal was a big move. It was a big move for me to go from Queen's Park Rangers to Arsenal at that time. But it didn't last long.
63 days.
63. Michael, it was the end of the season, May. And I signed. I had a few weeks off before pre-season, did pre-season. We started pre-season, went up to Scotland, played Aberdeen. We played Sir Alex Ferguson's Aberdeen, who were the top team in Scotland. And Glasgow Rangers, and then went to the old Belgrade and played in a 3-team tournament the weekend before the season was about to start. And as we came back through Heathrow Airport on the Monday morning, on the newsstands, on the newspapers, obviously no mobiles, no information at that time, the papers, the back page, you turn the lads were grabbing the papers as we were coming through, turned it round, Alan transfer. And I was still an Arsenal player. And obviously, Terry Venables had spoke to Terry Neal. He wanted me to go to Crystal Palace. The only way they could do the deal for Kenny Sansom to go to Arsenal, he said, you can take Kenny Sansom, but I want to take Clive Allen. And a swap deal took place on the Wednesday. And on the Thursday, I was a Crystal Palace player before the first game of the season. We were at Champions Liverpool on the opening day of the season. And there I was, opening day of the season in 1980. Playing against the champions Liverpool in a Crystal Palace shirt, having never played a competitive game for you know who.
Wow, that's some story. And that's why you can come on our podcast, because you didn't. You were right. Exactly. You're safe.
I can imagine that's one stat you're very proud of. Yeah. we're going to fast forward it to your Spurs career, Clark. I mean, it's worth mentioning for QPR, what a great team they were. You got to the FA Cup final.
Yeah.
Played against Spurs,
yeah. I made the fatal mistake of chasing Tony Galvin down the line in the second minute, and I wasn't one for tracking back. Yeah. And he turned inside. I tried to follow him, rolled my ankle. So I broke the caps with my ankle in the second minute of that Cup final. I thought over the course of the 2 games, QPR were very unlucky. Mm. Obviously, we were then a second division side against, obviously, Div 1 Tottenham, who went on to win the Cup. But so that first FA Cup final was an unfortunate one for me.
1984 then, Spurs come calling. I mean, I'm guessing you didn't really have to think twice about this one.
Not at all. No, I was back at QPR for a second spell, having been at Arsenal, back to QPR, and I remember getting indoors and the phone rang, and it was Peter Shreve, who was manager, he'd taken over from Keith Bergenshaw. And Peter Shreve had been the youth team coach when I came here as a schoolboy. My dad knew him well. They'd got on. And I remember him saying, Clivey, it's Shreve's here. I said, hello, Peter. What? He said, and this was his sales pitch. I think you know where the ground is. I'll see you in the morning. And I went, what? He said, yeah, we've agreed everything. It's all done. Steve Archibald had gone to Barcelona.
Yeah.
And obviously Spurs then. Contacted QPR and they were happy to sell me. And on the Thursday morning, I arrived at White Hart Lane, went into his office. He slid the contract across the desk, and I didn't even look at it, and I signed it, and he said, welcome. And it was like, well, I always felt fulfilling my destiny to obviously to arrive at the club. I knew a lot of the lads. It was seamless, just walking in.
Because you'd have had England teammates there.
Yeah, you? Mark Falco. Yeah. I played with England youth. I played against the lads many times, and been to Tottenham over the years as well. So it was the easiest of transitions to arrive here.
Even walking into a dressing room with Hoddle, Waddle, Ardiles, Clements. Do you know how was that? Because when I walked into a dressing room with superstars, I was always a little bit like, how will it take to me? I mean, probably different for yourself as a goal scorer.
No, absolutely, Michael. I had the same feelings. You had to have that sort of that nervous feel because you wanted to prove yourself to them. You wanted them to accept you, and you know, these Ozzy was a World Cup winner, as he told us many times, and Glenn was Glenn, and you know, so it was daunting. It really was, but I got off to a good start, which was obviously very, very important. And I just felt very much at home.
Did you say you got off to a good start, scoring two goals against Everton? Did that relax you, or did it just go?
It helps enormously. Not only with obviously your fellow teammates, but with supporters as well. You have to feel confident about doing the job that you do, and that scoring goals. So, scoring two at Goodison. Goodison was a good ground for me over the years. Was absolutely fantastic. A debutant that day as well scored, John Chidozie, who joined exactly the same day as I did. So for us, it was the perfect start. And Everton were a top team at that time. So to go away opening day of the season and win 4-1 was brilliant.
I mean, this would all come to fruition in 86, 87. But even at that time, you must have been licking your lips. You've got, as a striker, you've got Hoddle, you've got Waddle, you've got Ozzy, you've got all of these fantastic creative players who are ready just to provide you with the ammunition to go and do what you do.
Absolutely. I think that was one of the great attractions of it, obviously coming to the club, being able to sign for the club. But yeah, it was just a dream come true.
Last year we were talking about Haaland. Did you ever think 49 would ever get broken?
Yeah, a couple of times.
Did
you? It got a little bit scary. Ronaldo at Manchester United got 44, I think, one year. No, it's obviously a record I'm proud of. I'll never forget Jimmy Greaves. Mm. I did an interview at the beginning of that season. 10 games in, I had 10 goals. I did an interview on The Ball, his TV show. And obviously, he played with my dad. I knew Jimmy. It's all very relaxed. And he turned to me and said, you know what, son? He said, you could break my record. And Michael, I didn't have a clue what the record was. And I said, what record's that, Jim? Because I knew he had, obviously, and the most important one was the number of goals he scored in total at the club. But he said, I scored 44 in one
44,
season.
44, wasn't it? Yeah. Yeah.
He said, at this rate, he said, you'll break my record. And I just laughed at him. I said, Jim, you're joking. Yeah. It's impossible. Yeah. Absolutely impossible. But I equaled it in the semi-final in the game against Watford at Villa Park, and obviously was able to go on and get the 49th in the cup final. People said, well, why didn't you get 50? I scraped the bar in the cup final for my 50, if that's as close as I got. But no, it was just from day one, I scored a hat-trick opening day at Villa Park, and it just went from there, and there was chances and chances. And the thing that I always look back on with fondness was that season before, I'd had quite a nasty injury. I was out for almost a year, but I got back for the last 12 games of the previous season. And I got back, I scored a few goals, and David Pleat come in. And I'll never forget him saying in the summer break, he said, what's your plans for the summer? I said, I'm training all the way through. I said, if I've been out, I need to continue. He said to me, no, you need to go and have a holiday. He said, and start a couple of weeks before we start back. He said, you'll have a hard pre-season and you'll be up to speed for the start of the season. And I was in really good shape. I'd worked really hard because during the injury period, I really thought my career might be in doubt. Luckily, it wasn't. And I came back stronger, fitter, everything mentally very, very positive, and obviously got off to the perfect start.
So that's what you put it down to, basically, the off-season. You know, you missed so much the pre-season before, and then
absolutely,
you had a break and come back. I must admit, I had a period in my career where I think I played 13 here, and I had ankle, and I was the same. I was completely mentally, and I know what players go through, mentally as well as physically.
Well, I remember you arriving from Notts Forest.
And it was like, I needed that time to go, I'm going to keep fit, because we talk about players. I mean, now there's an awful lot of talk with people complaining about overload of football. But I think it's mentally as much as physically. I really, really do.
Because there's no break from it, is there?
No break. Yeah. You're under scrutiny all the time. But as a centre forward, you've had that break and you come back and get 49 goals. Absolute credit to you, Clive.
Let's paint a picture at 86-87, Clive, because there's a defining moment in this season, isn't there? Oxford away. So Pleat is in charge. Yeah. And seasons, you know, we're obviously a team under David Pleat with these players is always going to play good football. But you go to Oxford and you tell the story. What happened?
Well, it was Friday morning. We finished training at Chesham. We'd got David called a meeting and had all the first team squad there and said, right, lads, this is where we're going to play tomorrow with a five-man midfield. Glenn Hoddle will just play off of the front. And I was detailed to play as a striker on my own, as people thought. And he said, is there any thoughts, lads? And I'll never forget Glenn saying to him, I don't think this is going to work, Gaffer. And Ray Clements, God rest his soul, put his hand up. He said, no. He said, we tried that at Liverpool. It won't work. The extra man in midfield. No one had really adopted that. And I remember David saying, no, whatever happens, win, lose or draw, we're going to play this way and we're going to stick by it. It suits us perfectly with the players we have. So you can imagine we go to Oxford the following day. David Leeworthy, who'd been a striker for Spurs, was now at Oxford. We go one down. We're one down after about 10 minutes and the lads are looking at the dugout. You know, Gaffer, you're going to change it. We went on from there to win the game 4-2. I scored two. Chrissy Waddle scored two. And we just didn't look back. It was unbelievable the way that it just suited us. Glenn, he said Glenn was a free man, and he was. But what it was, Michael, we had an extra man in midfield. And the players we had, again, you know, Waddle, Hoddle, Ozzy Ardiles, my cousin Paul, played short, sharp football with the extra man in midfield. Teams didn't know what to do. Me as a lone striker, did the centre-half step out to become a midfield player? Did he stay in? If he stayed in, we had the extra. And it was just great. And for me, it was brilliant. People said you was on your own. I was never on my own because midfield players were joining. We built higher up the field with the ball and chances happened. I think we went on it was 13 games unbeaten run. And we were scoring freely. We were playing fantastic football.
Yeah, Doris, can you imagine playing centre-back and you've got a striker like Clive who's going to score 49 goals a season and who's providing the ammunition? Glenn Hoddle.
I'd be petrified. It's the same as Haaland. We talk about that era there and we look at it now. What your goal scorer, you're only as good as the surface you get, though.
And Absolutely.
Talked about Waddle, we talked about Ozzy, we talked about Waddle and all these players that you've got in there. As a striker, you're only as good as the surface. And this is what we say about Haaland and the record now of 52 he got last year. It's mind-blowing. And when we talked about yourself, Clive, last year on Sky, you think 49, it's never going to be... How are you going to score 52? This is like elite football.
I'm sure we're all going to be asked, and I've been asked since he broke that record, how many do you think he's going to get this season? I believe if he gets 30 goals this season, it would be absolutely sensational. Because, as you know, Michael, everybody would be looking at it.
Yeah.
What positions did he take up? Where was he? How does he... And obviously the attention that you would give a goal scorer of that ilk. So... if he returns 30 goals this year for Man City, even in obviously a treble winning team, I think that would be an amazing return.
That's
I really
interesting.
Do.
Interesting.
Well, go to the end of that season, so your 49th goal was in the FA Cup final. Look, you're a Spurs man through and through. Your dad won the double here. Jimmy Greaves is, you know, now, well, actually Harry's overtaken him, so Jimmy Greaves is seen as one of the greatest strikers of all time. But you beat his record. As a Spurs man through and through, how much did that mean to you, Clive, to beat Jimmy Greaves' record at that time of single goals in a season?
To be honest, Moses, I don't think I ever thought of it that way, even at the time. Because you're so focused on trying to score every game, every goal, every game, it wasn't the numbers, it was the next one. I've got to get the next one. That was something I think that was inbred in me. I'm proud, privileged that I had the opportunity, played in a great team, and was able to do what I did best, and that was score goals.
And you got PFA Player of the Year that year. And there's only David Ginola and Gareth Bale got that at this football club, so that must be a proud moment as well.
And Pat Jennings.
And Pat, sorry.
Big Pat, yeah. Well, the day before the awards ceremony, this was a funny story, Michael. I'm playing Norwich. We're playing Norwich City at home, and Norwich was full of four lads that had been playing at Spurs. Ian Culverhouse, Ian Crook, John Paulson, Mark Bowen were all playing for Norwich. And I had three touches in the game. I scored three goals. And as the third goal went in, as a turn to go back to the halfway line, Ian Crook, who was a real, it was a real character, Crook, he said to me, "You lucky." So I went, what are you talking about, Crookie? So I said, "I'm just doing what I do." He said, "You've had three touches and scored three goals, and you're going to win the PFA award tomorrow night." And I went, "What are you talking about?" He went, "Well, we've all voted for you, and I'm sure everybody else has." And it wasn't until that moment I actually thought, blimey, I might have a chance. Well, we talk about how good our lads were that season. Glenn was nominated, Chris Waddle, Ian Rush from Liverpool, and I was in there as well. And I'll never forget it, because Crookie just shook his head. He went, "Ah," he said, "I cannot believe it." He said, "You're so lucky." And I went, "Well," I said, "that's what I do, Crookie." Yeah. And it, on the Sunday night, obviously, I have to say, it's one of the, as an individual award for your fellow pros to nominate you for that. It's one of my prized possessions. Mm.
Now, how can we talk about regrets when you scored 49 goals in a season? But there are regrets, because that great team didn't win anything. And we finished third in the league, and we reached the semi-finals of the League Cup, and of course the FA Cup final when we won 1-0 up against Coventry, but we didn't win anything. And I know that sort of, I mean, I know a lot of the guys from that team, that sort of overshadows it a little bit, doesn't it? Because that team had to win something, right?
Yeah, I think what we produced, the football we produced, the
incredible
way we played,
football, wasn't it?
Yeah, and you know, I know many supporters now still talk to the lads who played in that team when we were in and around the club, of how much they enjoyed it. I do see a similarity, I have to say, with the new manager and the style of football that he wants 100%. The team to play in, which I think is really exciting. So it's something that I do hope we start well, and with that, the confidence. But yeah, we were very close, Milesy. As close as
I mean, it's still
close.
A fantastic season, don't get me wrong.
It was a great season, and I'll never forget, after the cup final, we were back at White Hart Lane for a banquet on the pitch, and Irving Scholar, the chairman, then came in and he stood up and spoke, and it resonates with me, because he said, "You've had a fantastic season. The club's had a fantastic season. We hadn't picked up silverware, and that was, you know, a big disappointment. But he acknowledged what we'd done, the way we'd played, and how close we'd gone." So it's never something that you want to remember with fondness at the time. But I have to say that when you look back, we were a very good side and an entertaining team.
Brilliant, brilliant. We're going to talk about your coaching time here, but I mean, if you were, I mean, as a player, if you could almost sum it all up at Spurs, I mean, it almost feels like it was meant to happen, without question. You came in, fans loved you, you scored all those goals. How would you sum it all up, Clive?
I fulfilled my destiny. I lived my dreams. I think, you know, as a youngster, Michael, you want to play professional football. I was privileged to be given that opportunity. I'd like to think I took that opportunity, but I just about fulfilled all my dreams that I'd hoped I would. And obviously, I'll never, ever forget my playing time here at the club.
Fantastic. And let's not forget, though, I mean, we are going to go into your coaching. But you had how many more years as a player here? I mean, because you went out to France, came back Man City, you played for West Ham for a little while as well, didn't you? So your career was still prolonged after leaving Spurs.
Yeah, I left here at 28. Obviously went to France for a year, went up to Manchester for 3 years, the City, came back to Chelsea.
A little bit different now, by the way.
Absolutely, yeah. It's a completely different club to the one I joined from Bordeaux in France. Back to Chelsea to West Ham, and finished my professional career with Millwall. So I play for most of the London clubs. Good memories. The majority of them were good memories. And as I say, I love playing. I love the opportunity of being a professional footballer as I was for 18 years.
Incredible. And then coaching. Was that something that was always in your mind? I know you came back in 2003. To the football club and work with the academy and the other, whether it's 20, 21s, 20?
Yeah, the development squad.
Was that something you always wanted to do as a player? You look to your next chapter of what you're going to do. Was that something that was always on the agenda?
Well, it was really interesting, Mark, because I finished my career at Millwall. I didn't know what I was doing, but a little bit like yourself, the guy who I'd worked for at Granada TV in Manchester when I was at City came up with the idea of Soccer Saturday at Sky. And he called me and said, Clive, he said, what's your plans with your career? I said, well, my career's coming to an end. He said, I've got this idea. I said, well, what's this then? Mark, his name was, at Sky. And he said, it's radio on TV. So I said, what are you talking about? So he said, we can have the feeds of the games coming in. You can tell the public what's going on. He said, I want former players who sort of have obviously an insight into it to tell people what's going on, the scores, whatever. He said, there'd be four of you on the panel. He said, we've got six pilot shows. He said, and if Sky like it, they're going to commission it for a season. Yeah, I'll try that. I'd finished playing. I wasn't obviously going to be doing anything else at that time. I'd started my coaching badges when I was playing and always wanted a coach. And obviously the rest is history. Did six pilots. We did the following season. And I did 8 years at Sky, the first 8 years of Soccer Saturday, which was brilliant. Mm. Listen, I couldn't play, but I could sit and I could talk to people and tell people, just giving an insight into how I saw it, how you call a game. And everybody, as you know, Michael, you sit there now, other lads will call it different to the way that you... But the concept worked, and here we are today, and Michael's on Soccer Saturday. Yeah. At that same time, I worked with the FA, with the England youth groups. I was doing my coaching badges, but I had the opportunity to work with, obviously, elite groups in the younger age groups, gaining my coaching experience. And as the Sky thing came to an end, David Pleat, who was here, obviously, as a director of football at the time, he called me and he said, Clive, what's your plans? Because he knew that my time at Sky was finishing. He knew that I'd been coaching with the FA. He said, you want to coach, don't you? And I've always the utmost respect for David. I said, yeah, I do. He said, well, there might be an opportunity to come back to the club. He said, would you like to come in, just do some work for... It was the last 3 months of the season. And I did. I loved it, Michael. The first morning I walked in, put the kit on, went out on the training pitch, went out on the grass, as they say, worked with the young lads. And it didn't take any persuasion from David. He said, look, I don't know what the situation is, what's unfolding with the manager, what's going to happen. He said, but would you like to do it? I said, yeah, absolutely. And that was the start of it. And obviously it went on from there for another 8-9 years that I was here as a coach. So fabulous.
You got to think, like, when you joined us, Clive, as a coach, not only had you had your career, but you think of some of the coaches you play, like Terry Venables, David Pleat, some of the people you played under. You brought all that to the table, didn't you, when you rejoined the club as a coach?
Well, I like to think that was important in terms of what I brought to the table. I had obviously you have your own ideas as the way you want the game played, the types of things that would work, that wouldn't work. One of the fundamentals I always like to think that I brought was I was still thinking like a player. I was still a player. In the sessions, I was a player. Am I enjoying this? Is this working? Is this good for me? And that was something that I felt was really important. I'd like to think I struck up good relationships with the players. I love to communicate. Did loads of work with Jermaine Defoe, obviously, and strikers in particular. Probably enjoyed most of all working with the strikers.
Always because, remember them strike, then get them finishing sessions, Clive.
You know,
always.
And even then, I could barely run, could barely kick the ball, but I still wanted to beat Jermaine in a shooting session, or Harry as he emerged as a really young talent as well. So I'd like to think that you give them little nuggets that they can take and they can use for their benefit as their careers go on. And yeah, I loved every minute of it. I really did. Obviously, with a development squad, going on to working with the first team and working with Michael and the boys for a number of years under Harry. You know, some fabulous times qualifying for the Champions League, the first Champions League campaign, going to the quarterfinals. It was, you know, it was just fantastic.
Before we talk about the first team, let's just stay with the development group. What players did you sort of look at there that thought they've got a chance? Apart from Harry, you touched on the striking work you did with him. But what other players were in that group of yours that went on to?
Well, we had some interesting ones, and again, it was all part of my coaching experience as well. Adil Tarap came in.
What a talent, honestly,
unbelievable talent, and I've gone on record as saying he knocked on my door 3 days in. Come in, Adil. How's things? You enjoying it? Are you settling? Do you like it? Yes, coach, I love it. He said, but I must play in the first team. So I said, yeah, we know. We want you to play in the first team. He said, but you must build the team around me. He said, I am Zinedine Zidane.
And I was like, I can imagine, Adele.
You would know, wouldn't you?
Honestly, I can imagine.
And I was, yeah, Adele, okay. So obviously then I relate to Harry, who's the manager. And you can imagine what Harry said. But they were good times for me as a coach to deal with that.
Let's not forget you won the Premier League reserve title during that time as well.
Yeah, we did. Lee Barnard leading the line. There was a number of talented players in that group. Jamie O'Hara played a part. Unfortunately, a number of them, and I'll forget, and I'm making excuses now, actually, Martin Yole took them with the first team for the Saturday game when we was at Manchester on the Wednesday night for the final.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So we lost the national final to Ole Gunnar Solskjaer's Manchester United at that time, who had a very, very strong team. Rob Birch was in goal and got badly injured that night.
He did, yeah. So what happened, Dawes? So that in the reserves, like the North and the South, would then meet in a final. The champions would meet in a final. So we played at Old Trafford.
I remember Lee Barnard. I always put Lee and Harry sort of in the same bracket.
Yeah,
when I was in the first team, I'd always have an interest in the younger groups. And Barney was someone who'd always score goals.
Yeah.
Every reserve game. One 5-0, got four. And Harry was the same. And I played when Lee made his debut against Manchester United.
That's right.
And he just never quite...
Never quite established himself at that level. But, you know, I'd like to think I helped him. Yeah. He developed that in his game. He became a consistent goal scorer. And you get great feeling about that when you can help youngsters. There was a lot of youngsters. I'll never forget young Adam Smith, a right back, who played in a game at Ebbsfleet against Charlton for us, and he was 15. Wow. And Alex Inglethorpe, who was a youth team coach, called him the morning of the game, said, I need a young right back. He said, have you got anyone? And he didn't. He said, I've got a kid who's just come in as a schoolboy, Adam Smith. He said, Clivey can do it. And it's like 15-year-old coming into what is in effect a reserve team game. And I'll never forget that night. He ran up and down, up and down, up and down. He's incredible.
And he's had a great career.
He's had a very, very good career.
Obviously, has done brilliantly at Bournemouth over the years.
Okay, Clive. So now we're sort of hitting 2008 and Harry came in and you sort of step up from that development work into the first team setup, which you'd always sort of been part of because you were always doing the goal, the finishing, and always doing that. But now you become part of the first team coaching setup. Young Michael Dawson's there, and this team is going to go on and qualify for the Champions League. I mean, what were you seeing from this group of players when Harry came in? We were pretty much at rock bottom, but. 2 points from eight
we
games.
We were at rock bottom, yeah.
And I'll never forget that first day because obviously I'd played for Harry at West Ham. He'd known that I'd been working with a development squad, but asked me to come on to the, obviously with the staff, with the first team. And that very first morning, you were there, Michael. I'm sure you remember it. And he pulled about 32 players together. Whereas Wanda Ramos before him had literally had a group of 18.
To be fair, Clive, I wasn't there because I'd got sent off a week before at Stoke. So I got a call on Sunday morning. We all met at the hotel, didn't we? And I drove my car to Canary Wharf. I remember it. I was suspended for Harry's first three games.
But that first morning with Harry, and he in the office before, he said to me, Clivey, what's been going on? He said, how can this group of players only have 2 points from the first eight games? Brought them together, and I'll never forget all the boys that had been, was in the bomb squad, who'd been in with the reserve team. They all came in, and Harry just looked at them in the face. He said, look, it's very basic. I can only pick 11 to play every week, but you're all involved. Not over there, you're here, you'll be with us. You've all got a chance. And he literally just wiped the slate clean. you could see that the players that were actually in Ramos's thinking at the time, there was a relief lifted from them because they were looking at it thinking, I make a mistake and I get bombed, I'm over there, I'm completely out of it. And there was no grey area with one day. It was just the way he worked. And Harry just went, no, come on, lads, you're all together. And obviously the ones that had come back across and come into the group, they were like, I've got a chance here. Mm. And we went on an unbelievable run. The confidence, the way Harry wanted the team to play, and it worked. It just worked. It picked up. And we had a lot of ability in that group, a lot of ability, which again, he harnessed. It come together, and we started getting results.
Echoing what Clive just said, I remember the meeting. I remember Saturday night. I think we played on Sunday. We played Bolton his first game.
Yeah,
I'm sure it was a Sunday, whatever night it was. Anyway, I was at home, and mum and dad had come down, and then I see it, and then I get a message. We're all having a meeting at 11 o'clock tomorrow. Harry's coming in, and yourself and Kevin Bond
Kevin and Joe,
and then we literally Clive's right, we all met at the hotel, so the group of players were there, the rest of them went back to the stadium. He just galvanises, didn't he? There was something not right. We're all lacking belief, lacking confidence, and he just lifted the spirit. It was, couldn't believe it. He said, how have this group of players got 2 points from 8 games? That's how easy it was. And he was just a great manager. And he was
absolutely
spirit, yeah. Morale, and he got the best out of. I always say Harry was the best manager I played under, just because of
his man management.
It was incredible.
Yeah, let's put this man under the spotlight. And Clive, what do you remember about him as a player? I mean, I always think Ledley was captain, but Dawes was captain as well, really, wasn't he? He was a leader of men. Dawes,
absolutely. You're right, Milesy. He was a leader. He was a communicator. He led by example, the way he played, committed, totally committed to the job in hand. You knew what you were getting, and consistent. I think that was the thing with Michael. You know, I'd been in many offices after games where managers and coaches sit. Everybody asks, who's your leaders? Who's your communicators? And obviously, Michael's name was always mentioned. And it was great working with him. I enjoyed the whole experience. Obviously, that next level, working with top players who still wanted to improve, wanted to get better, wanted to be successful. And that is exactly what Michael did all his career. And you know, had a great career, which he deserved because of what he put in and what he put in, day out.
I always remember Clive going in the rondos.
You never lose that, Clive, do you?
Clive going in the rondos. And what I always remember is, because I used to stand behind the goal taking photos of it, where his finishing sessions. I've got photos of a finishing session, and it's Bale, Van der Vaart, Defoe.
Luca would have been there, but he was useless.
Pav, Luca, JJ.
I mean, it's so...
And it's Clive running this finishing session. And I always used to think, I wonder if they knew that he scored 49 goals in the season once for this club. I wonder if they knew that. He was so good, Clive. He was so good.
I still can't get my head around it. And I think that's when you put things into perspective as a professional footballer, when you've played, and I speak about it all the time at this football club. World-class players, but 49 in the season. It's mind-blowing. Anyway, we've spoke about that. Did you ever want to be a manager, Clive? Did you ever think, look, I've done my groundwork, I've worked in development, I've gone to the first team, I want to be the governor?
Yeah, absolutely, Michael. I did, because, again, that was the next step, that was the next test, the next challenge. And I'd felt that I'd done the hard yards, so to speak. Again, I come back to the new manager. He's done the hard yards in respect 100%. Of gaining experience at all different levels, being successful at all different levels, and I'd had that. Obviously, I hadn't had a number one position apart from with the development squad. Where again, I go back to David Pleat, and David said to me, you know, you're in a position now as a development squad manager coach to try some things, learn things, try things, and you'll develop as a coach and a manager. And I really enjoyed that. I was given license to do that. And obviously with One Day, when One Day was in charge, he literally said to me, Clive, do what you want with them. Yeah. You know, coach them the way you want, play the way you want, use the players in the way you want. And I felt that was a great education for me. And obviously working alongside Harry, then you see, like Michael says, you see a man manager who's as good as there is. And the way that obviously he used his coaches, Kevin, Joe and myself as coaches, and how he gave them license as well. He gave them some opportunity to take sessions with the top players. And then the opportunity when I left, I went for a few positions, went very close, but lost out because I hadn't any experience, which again is the way of the world, in certainly in football. But my media career took off, so that was something that I enjoyed because I love talking about football. Yeah. I love the game.
Yeah, that, I mean, the people now know you as such a great pundit, Clive, and obviously you've worked for TV, TalkSport. Now, luckily for us, you're working a lot on Spurs Play and doing a bit of co-commentary with Rob. Obviously the media thing, you started it with it on Soccer Saturday, and it's something that's both, it comes naturally to the pair of you, obviously, but you're right, it's that love of the game, it just shines through, Clive, and the love of Spurs shines through when you're doing it for us, for sure.
Yeah, no, obviously with Spurs Play taking off, growing, and being involved right at the start now, I'm just really excited, really enjoy it. Like to feel, as you say, get across my passion for one, the game, and then the club. I'd love nothing more than for us to be successful, to move forward. I think, you know, everything's in place. There's absolutely no doubt about that for me, that the club will grow, will get better. And hopefully success will come very soon.
How do you sum it all up, Clive?
I just love...
From being in your mum's belly at Wembley in 61 to this minute.
It was meant to be. As I said, it was my destiny to be part and parcel of Tottenham Hotspur through my life. And I've loved every minute of it and still do.
So before we let you go, Clive, everyone who sits on our podcast, 7 questions. What's the best memorabilia you own?
Diego Maradona's boots that were mine that he played in against Inter Milan in Ozzy Ardiles' testimonial.
Come on, Clive, tell the story.
Oh my gosh.
Tell the story,
that's not
Clive.
Bad, is
well,
it?
it's one. Jenna was our winner before this. Do you know what Jenna had?
Go on.
A court hanger.
No.
A first court hanger. It was an amazing story, but wow, Clive. Sorry, Jenna.
Tell us about this story,
it.
Clive.
I think this tops it.
Come on.
So, Monday night, White Hart Lane, Ozzy Ardiles' testimonial. The week before, it was rumoured that Diego was going to play. And the lads, for a week, was saying to Ozzy, come on, Ozzy, is Diego, is he guesting on Monday? I know nothing. We were like, come on, Ozzy, it's your testimonial. And it was, I reckon, 6 o'clock, dressing room door opened, and in walks Ozzy with his biggest smile on his face. Michael, when I say, there's this little bloke, it's Maradona, right? And the lads were sitting in the dressing room, and all their faces and their tongues were, oh my God, it's Diego. He came in, one of the lads joined in, brilliant, went into the treatment room, and his ankles, both ankles, he'd played in Italy for Napoli just a day or so
before. This is Maradona, 86.
So he's at the top of his game. He came back into the dressing room, he had ankles like footballs, like the brutality that he'd taken in Serie A. Stripped off, got his kit on, and he says, has anyone got any boots? 6.5, Puma.
I was just about to say Puma Kings, right?
Because he best player in the world. He didn't bring any boots with
him. I'm sure he could have made a phone call, send me some Pumas over.
So I put my hand up. I said, yeah, I have. I had one pair of boots that I'd worn once in training. I was breaking in. And I had the pair of boots I'd worn all season. So Ozzy translating, brought him over. I said, Diego, please be my guest. So he wasn't silly, was he? He said, I'll have the old ones because they're broken. And I'm like, I'm looking at Ozzy going, no, Oz, I want to wear them. In the end, we persuaded him to wear the once worn new ones. So Diego wore the boots. And I always say, I've said this many times before, that was the only game I played in as a professional that I was a spectator, because you're watching the game and you just wanted him and Glenn to get the ball, because Michael, they were on another planet. They were on another level. Honestly, it was unbelievable. He made the winning goal for me, an overhead kick from the corner of the penalty box, kicked it to the back post, which I had to head in for the winning goal. We won 2-1. And afterwards, he signed the boots. and I've still got them today. So that's my prized memorabilia collection.
Are they going on sale? For £6 million quid, mate.
You can't put a price on them, Michael.
I've not often seen him gobsmacked, but you are gobsmacked. There you go.
Yeah, and that's the only pair of boots I ever kept, would you believe? And still got them.
Very good. I like it.
That's not bad, is it?
Not getting topped that. Sorry. All our guests.
Second question, Clive. What is your favourite Spurs kit ever?
All white for the kit we wore at Wembley in the 87 Cup final. And I've said it in commentary with Rob already this season. I love the new kit.
Yeah. All white. I know
traditionally it's white shirt, blue shorts, white socks. But for me, Spurs in all white, which traditionally and historically is for European games, we're going to have a good season in all white. I believe it.
I like it. Favourite Spurs all-time player?
Wow. That's a tough one. Really, really is a tough one.
Played with or watched? Either or.
Well, I go back to my dad telling me to watch Jimmy Greaves as a goal scorer, and he was quite sensational in terms of the different types of goals he scored. So I watched a lot of footage of Jimmy, and he would certainly be up there. But as I say, because of my experience, Glenn was just different class as a striker. Yeah. In terms of his passing ability, his skill, his game awareness as well. I'd have to say Glenn.
Next up, imagine putting together an all-time Spurs five-a-side team. Now, you can do this from anyone, but let's say with the players you played with.
Players I played with, Ray Clements, Richard Gough. Players I played with, Diego Maradona, Glenn Hoddle.
You're and top. Yourself. Job done. You've got to put yourself
to be fair, that team ain't losing many games.
We've only got Goffey at the back and he'd be moaning, but he was a good, very, very, very good player.
I remember watching him at Forest when he came there in the latter stage of his career.
Incredible. Yeah. Young lad. Him and Mabsy together one season. Yeah. That season.
Fantastic, yeah.
86, 87, incredible.
If there's one bit of advice you could give to anyone, player, not player, what would it be?
You can always get better. Simple as that.
Simple as that,
I like it.
Yeah.
In any walk of life, I like it.
Absolutely.
Next up, who is your unsung hero at Tottenham Hotspur?
Unsung hero?
Unsung hero.
Could currently
be,
or...
Could be from, a, anyone who's...
Maybe
anyone,
someone you played with.
Well, I'm going to be really biased here and people say boring, but it would be my cousin Paul in respect of the career he had here. Obviously, it was a difficult move coming from West Ham in 85, so he joined the year after I did. It was great that, you know, my cousin was going to come and play and we played together.
Lovely photo of you together when he joined, yeah.
Yeah, and I've got a great picture of us at the Champions League final as well in Madrid, which was wonderful. So we've shared some good times here, but I think it was sort of underestimated the contribution he made as a player.
He played
here.
370 games for us, Clive.
Absolutely, yeah. Won the FA Cup. He won the FA Cup in 91.
That era, we had so many more superstars, as you could say.
Yeah,
when you
absolutely.
Had yourself,
yeah.
Chrissy Waddle, Glenn
Michael,
Hoddle.
when that season, obviously the role that he played on the right-hand side, when you, and it's no disrespect to any of those players I played with, but, you know, Glenn wasn't one to track back and Chrissy Waddle was fabulous going forward and a wonderful dribbler with the ball. But Paul did an amazing job, in that system. He was a fabulous player, but... You know, at times I didn't think got the credit that he deserved.
Clive, thank you again for taking the time out to come and relive your journey and being a Spurs legend. 49 goals in one season, mind blowing. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Michael. A pleasure.